Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fuck You, I'm Irish. Why We Irish Are Awesome, by Rasher Tierney. Narrated by Gary Furlong. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to illustrations and maps present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Chapter 1. Setting Aside the Clichés. From our fightin nature and inherent good luck to our potato-eating and St. Patrick's Day parading, the clichés regarding us Irish are famous. But our true awesomeness stems not from a few lame stereotypes. Rather, it can be found in the countless accomplishments for which we are not given proper credit. That is, until now. Serving up the truth like a perfect pint of Guinness, here are the fun and informative facts about the best feckin' people in the world, the Irish. Astonishing historical accounts, profiles of Irish heroes, stories of struggles and success, language, music, culture, we've got them all. So get ready to push out your chest, proudly look the world in the eye and say, Fuck you, I'm Irish. The humble spud of life, death and exodus. The potato is inextricably linked not only with the Irish diet, but with the whole of Irish culture and history. However, potatoes were rarely seen in Ireland before British explorer Sir Walter Raleigh popularised them on his lands in the 1580s. The potato proved remarkably easy to cultivate in Ireland and packed an extraordinary nutritional punch, complete with protein, vitamins and complex carbohydrates. The Irish wholeheartedly adopted this new wonder food. The typical Irish peasant ate about 10 pounds of potatoes each day and soon towered in physical size over their rural English equivalents, who mainly ate bread. Infant mortality declined dramatically among the Irish. From 1780 to 1840, the population doubled, zooming from 4 million to 8 million. There was one flaw. As much as 60% of the Irish people were solely dependent on the humble spud as their main food source. Then came the devastating blight, a malign misfortune that was to change the course of Ireland and the United States forever. This fast-growing fungus spurred mildew to form on all parts of the potato plant, causing entire fields to rot within days. To great dismay, the crops in 1845, 1846, and 1847 were decimated, leaving a vast quantity of the unfortunate Irish without any food or livelihood. This led to widespread death from starvation and disease, and mass exodus to the US. It was a number of years before it was discovered that spraying the fields with a solution of copper sulfate effectively protected the potato crop. But by then, the horrific damage to the Irish population, economy and culture had been done. Ireland would never fully recover from this dire catastrophe. Meanwhile, an ocean away, the US would grow and prosper like never before, thanks greatly to its new population of Irish immigrants. Fighting Irish. There's incredible fire in the Irish temperament. Whether it's with a stinging verbal put-down or a mean left hook, the Irish are not afraid to defend their homes, their families, and their rights. Just like Notre Dame's feisty leprechaun mascot, Irish immigrants became known in the New World for a refusal to give up and simply take no for an answer. Banging away at the slammed doors of Anglo-Saxon America's prejudice, this tough and fearless people kept trying and fighting until they overcame injustice and intolerance. Be it in the rough-and-tumble world of inner-city politics or the bare-knuckle boxing ring, the Irish rightly earned their fightin moniker. These hard-as-nails immigrants weren't bickering over a few pints of Guinness or who insulted whose granny. They were battling for respect, freedom, and prosperity in their adopted country. The luck of the Irish. Sure, you've all heard about the Irish and their amazing luck. You've probably even bought lottery scratch cards festooned with shamrocks, leprechauns, rainbows, and pots of gold. Are the Irish any luckier than anybody else? Let's look at the evidence, shall we? Brutally oppressed by England, the Irish were forced to abandon their homeland in the millions, only to meet with poverty and no Irish need apply signs wherever they went. The Irish variant of good fortune usually seems to be defined by down on their luck. The concept of Irish being blessed in any way could potentially be viewed as the cruelest joke ever. Still, there is a certain Irish cussedness and willingness to take wild and crazy chances that may end up leading to lots of good fortune. And then there's the distinctive Irish exuberance and willingness to celebrate any incidents of random windfall. Maybe that's why everybody regarded the Irish as lucky. Anytime something did go right, they were up drinking and carrying on until the break of dawn. So maybe we Irish are just more inclined to celebrate and share our good luck with all who are around when it occurs. Just hope you're lucky enough to be there the next time one of us hits it big. St. Patrick's Day, the sober version. Before you start rubbing your hands in glee, anticipating riotous escapades involving dozens of cute colleens with skimpy green tops, glittery face paint and barrels of green beer, know that St. Patrick's Day in Ireland was traditionally a quiet, church-oriented affair. The typical Irish family would rise early and find a solitary sprig of shamrock to put on their sombre Sunday best. Then they'd spend the morning in church listening to sermons of how thankful they should be that St. Patrick saved a bunch of ungrateful sinners. Nobody wore green, as it was considered an unlucky colour not suitable for church. Fun stuff, eh? It gets better. Rather than spending the rest of the day gallivanting around the town, square-tossing green beads and asking complete strangers to smooch under the shamrocks, there was a quiet, sober parade promoting responsibility and community values, with no drunken shenanigans whatsoever. You see, St. Patrick's Day, Good Friday and Christmas Day were the 3 days of the year when the pubs weren't allowed to open. Yep, you heard it right, folks. The towns and villages of Ireland were dry as a rock in the desert on Ireland's National Feast Day. People generally just gathered for a hearty family meal, somewhat like the US Thanksgiving feast, annoyed the hell out of each other, and had an early night. Parading with pride. Yep, the massive, spectacular parades attended by impressive crowds are an American innovation. The largest St. Patrick's Day parade in the US takes place in New York, where the event draws an average of 2 million people of all nationalities. The second largest celebration is held in Boston. This South Boston parade is probably the nation's oldest, first being hosted by the Charitable Irish Society of Boston all the way back in 1737. Another early March 17th celebration took place in New York City in 1762, when Irishman John Marshall held a celebration in his house. Little is known about the event except the guests apparently marched in a festive formation to his gathering. The first organized modern New York parade was held in 1766, when military units strode at dawn from the house of one leading Irish citizen to the next. Over the years, as the parade grew in strength, it became a chance for the Irish to gather and demonstrate their combined political influence. Apart from showing that they were a force to be reckoned with, it was, of course, also a chance to blow off some steam and have a grand old time. In its current incarnation, the parade is about Irish heritage, with the added benefit that everyone else gets a chance to join in and become green for the day. Meanwhile, back in Ireland, the parade has become Americanized in the last decade or two. Irish people now don the same kind of crazy get-ups that they do in the US. Chapter 2. How the Irish Made America. While the Great Famine was a major motivation for Irish emigration to the United States, this movement was well underway prior to the famine and continued long after its effects subsided. The main impetus for the mass migration was a potent combination of religious persecution, unfeasible rents, and the constant threat of eviction from the land. The treacherous and unreasonable nature of English rule had a lot to do with all of the aforementioned factors. For a people who struggled under British control, the United States held an allure, as the colony that had set itself free of imperial rule. Their desire to better themselves combined with abundant American opportunities meant that most Irish saw the US as a promised land. From the birth of America to the modern day, the Irish have had a dynamic and far-reaching effect on the development of their adopted country. Often they've had to push their way through the doors of power. Having come so far and suffered so much, they were not going to be denied. Whether serving in the military, building industry, organizing politically, or making their way in any other part of American culture, the Irish were determined to create a free and prosperous life for themselves. This Irish-American struggle led to social and political progress for all Americans. Fightin' for America. The Irish have played a part in every military conflict on American soil since the founding of the Republic. Donegal-born Richard Montgomery was the first American general to lose his life in the Revolutionary War. In fact, one British major general at the time told the House of Commons that half the rebel Continental Army was from Ireland. Some 26 American generals either were born in Ireland or had Irish ancestry. A standout for her heroism and accomplishments in American military history was Lydia Barrington Darrah, 1729 to 1789, born in Dublin, who spied for George Washington. Then there was brave Hercules Mulligan, a most resourceful spy in the American Revolution. Mulligan emigrated from Derry to New York City, where he led the Sons of Liberty in their famous assault on King George III's statue in Bowling Green. They toppled it to the ground and melted its lead down for bullets to be used against the king's troops. Take that, symbol of British power! Mulligan stayed in the city during the British takeover, slyly pretending to be a loyalist himself. In secret, he was listening intently to British soldiers' plans, since they often chatted in his clothing store. In this way, Washington learned that British agents planned to kidnap him. After the Americans took control of the city, many accused Mulligan of being a Tory. But in 1783, Washington declared Mulligan a true friend of liberty, which settled the matter. For his services to his adopted country, this courageous Irishman deserves to be remembered as Mulligan the Mighty. John Barry, 1745 to 1803, hailing from Wexford, is known as the father of the American Navy. He came to Philadelphia as a cabin boy of 15 and rose to become a captain. In the First Continental Navy, he commanded the USS Lexington to become the first of the fleet to take a British ship. Recalled from private shipping after the war, he helped establish the young nation's new navy. Moving forward in time, we have William J. Donovan, 1883 to 1959, a World War I hero who later set up the Office of Strategic Services. Let's not forget General Douglas MacArthur, 1880 to 1964, who led World War II's Allied forces in the Pacific. Finally, let's tip our hats to Audie Murphy, 1925 to 1971, the most decorated US soldier in World War II, who in his second career as a popular movie actor fought the war again in many Hollywood movies. Democracy, power, and political machines. With our gift for language and willingness to stand up and be counted, as well as heaps of charm and charisma, we Irish have long been an integral part of American political life. The very first reading of the Declaration of Independence before Congress was a rousing rendition by none other than Charles Thompson, an Irish-born former indentured servant who rose to Secretary of the Continental Congress. Irish Catholics with experience in mass agitation movements against tyranny in their homeland realized that politics could provide a means for attaining influence and power. In the years after the Civil War, Irish clout in city politics became increasingly evident across the United States. Though subtle string-pulling and skillfully playing the game were undoubtedly vital to many of their political machines in New York and other cities, Irish politicians frequently helped the unemployed obtain jobs and organized other practical aid to the less fortunate. In the rough-and-tumble sphere of New York City politics, the Irish fighting spirit was channeled through the massive Tammany Hall political machine. This largely Irish institution may not always have played by the rules, but times were tough, and for a people fleeing famine and a repressive regime, bending the laws and rigging the game seemed a better option than waiting around for a fair deal to be handed to them on a plate. A few probably enriched themselves along the way, believing that in a dog-eat-dog world, the only problem with tainted money is tainted enough of it for everybody. While the machine's methods were not completely above board, it fought against entrenched political elites. And in their own way, Tammany politicians helped extend political power to the masses, making American democracy more inclusive of all its citizens. A hard day's work. It's often said that the Irish built America. The truth is, not only did they build it, they also manufactured, repaired, and cleaned it, especially in the decades before and after the potato famine. As they were largely poor, unconnected, uneducated, and discriminated against, many unskilled Irish women and men found the strongest economic opportunities in industrial work, domestic service, and blue-collar public works positions. From 1850 onward, more and more immigrants got a head start in America in the form of welcoming relatives who provided moral support, a financial safety net, and whatever connections they might have had. Irish immigrants quickly found employment, mostly blue-collar, in the police and fire departments and other public institutions of the larger cities, due in some part to the influence of Irish political machines in the urban areas of the Northeast. Toward the end of the 19th century, teaching became the sought-after occupation for a second generation of female Irish immigrants. By 1890, 40% of the go-getting second-generation Irish in Boston held white-collar jobs. Finally, through the growing network provided by Catholic colleges and the rapidly expanding system of public education, Irish Americans began to establish notable footholds in skilled professions like law and medicine. In 1903, Sir James Power, Lord Mayor of Dublin, was surprised to note on a transatlantic trip that the typical Irish immigrant in America was now not merely a hewer of wood and a drawer of water. In fact, he remarked that they are found occupying respectable positions in society. Women's work in the New World. Rather surprising for such a dangerous venture, women made up over half of those departing from Ireland for America. They left a land where, frankly, women were undervalued within a strongly patriarchal society. Besides the usual household work, women often handled the family finances. Many were sent to cities to be shop assistants or carry out domestic work. With few prospects at home for single women, called unprovided for girls, their families often saved to send them to America. When audacious Irish women arrived in the States, they did not leave their knowledge and skills behind. They often gravitated to domestic work. Home workers were in great demand in wealthy middle-class and upper-middle-class homes of the 19th century. Armies of young Irish women found positions as live-in domestics. Imagine a world with few of the home conveniences we have today. Everything had to be done by hand. Even toast was made over an open fire. And the servant's life was undoubtedly a hard one. Yet with room and board provided for, many were able to save impressive sums, which they sometimes used to set up small businesses. In the 1870s, it was estimated that a third of all the money in the Irish economy came from money sent by kind-hearted Irish servant girls to their families. The Emigrant Industrial Savings Bank in New York alone would send more than $30 million to Ireland between 1850 and 1880. Many families in Ireland owed their survival to what they gratefully called the American Letter, a lifeline that helped them cope with brutal poverty and lack of opportunity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.